Hey everyone, welcome back to Seeker Plus and our final episode on Venus. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and today I'm going to start off with a question that you might have already started to ask yourself. Is it me or does it feel like Venus is suddenly everywhere in the news?
Scientists discovering possible signs of life on Venus.
NASA has announced two new missions to explore our planetary neighbor, Venus.
At one point, we thought Venus could be a tropical paradise, but now we know it's our evil twin. Explain.
We have also started to cover Venus more as well, and if you haven't seen our recent videos yet, I'll drop a link in the description below. So what's going on here? Why is Venus in the spotlight at the moment? Is it just temporary, or should we get used to seeing and hearing more about the second planet from the sun moving forward? To understand why Venus is seemingly everywhere today, I've got to back up a couple of decades. So, from about the 60s to the 80s, Venus was actually a central focus of space exploration. It was the planet next door that we could reach in shorter and cheaper intervals than sending spacecraft to our other planetary neighbor, Mars. But by the 90s, like a broken VCR, things took a hard pause. The Soviet Union, which had already sent their fair share of missions to Venus, including the only successful landers, was going through some pretty dramatic changes. If you weren't around back then, it wasn't a simple rebrand. The USSR dissolved into 15 independent republics, and with its collapse, interest and money were focused elsewhere, to say the least. That was the main reason why the Russians' attention on Venus waned at that time, but for the Americans, it was a different story. There were claims about potential life on Mars, including one from NASA suggesting that they had found microscopic fossils in a Martian meteorite. Obviously, that sent shockwaves through the scientific community and even reached receptive ears in the White House. In 1996, President Clinton gave a speech about this discovery and said, "I am determined that the American space program will put its full intellectual power and technological prowess behind the search for further evidence of life on Mars." Look, I'm not great at impressions, but I feel like if you quote Clinton, you have to try, right? So that was a pretty big endorsement from the president, and since then, NASA has landed 8 spacecraft on the red planet without direct evidence of Martian life yet, I might add, but that's besides the point. What I want you to take away from this is that for the last 30 years, Mars has clearly been getting all the attention. I mean, NASA's flying a freaking helicopter around on it right now. NASA's former chief scientist Jim Green wants to terraform it, and Elon Musk says that he thinks spacecraft would be landing on Mars in the next 5 years. Are we all obsessed or what? This dedication, shall we call it, is warranted in many respects, and scientists have learned a ton about Mars. I ain't a Mars hater. However, for some Venus evangelists, it has pulled focus away from our other neighboring planet, to the point that it took a study suggesting that life could exist in the clouds of Venus to get anyone's attention. You remember that study from the fall of 2020? There was a lot going on back then, I understand if you missed it, so I'll recap. A group of astronomers claimed they found signals of phosphine gas in Venus's atmosphere, between 48 and 60 kilometers above the surface, where conditions aren't completely deadly. See, on Earth, anaerobic bacteria produce this gas, and so the idea goes that there could be microbes making this gas in the atmosphere of Venus. Pretty soon after the study was published, planetary scientists started to call the findings into question, and it came out that the original data from the observatory had some complications. While the findings are certainly questionable, the study, seemingly accidentally, put Venus back in the spotlight overnight. It got people excited about Venus in a way they hadn't been in decades. It was also a stark reminder that we know so little about this forgotten neighbor. A lot of what we do know about Venus comes from observations from the 70s. So, both of these things, excitement and intrigue, or as I call it, excitatrigue, are two necessary ingredients for any space mission. Now, I'm not suggesting that either had any impact on what NASA would do next, but I also can't guarantee that it didn't convince a few stalwarts in charge. In the summer of 2021, as part of NASA's Discovery program, two missions to Venus were selected, which is a big deal. As I mentioned in part 2 of the series, since the 90s there have been more than 30 Venus proposals to NASA, but none were chosen. One of the two recent missions that was selected is called Da Vinci Plus. The mission will include an orbiter and a descent probe. The orbiter has four cameras on board that will image Venus in multiple wavelengths from above, but the probe will have a slightly more treacherous journey. It will plummet through the thick sulfuric acid clouds, taking measurements the whole time until it reaches the surface where, because of the intense heat and pressure, the probe is expected to survive for only around 20 minutes. 50 years after Venera 7, and we're still trying to survive as long as that first lander on Venus did. Now, 20 minutes doesn't sound like a lot of time, but as we know, any minute a spacecraft can survive on Venus's killer conditions is worth celebrating. The probe will measure Venus's atmosphere in greater detail by using a couple of spectrometers to determine the compounds that make it up. Scientists are hoping these findings will shed new light on how and when the atmosphere got so bad. Venus wasn't always the hellish place that it is today. It's theorized Venus may have even had an ocean almost 700 million years ago, until a runaway greenhouse effect suffocated the planet. So knowing more about what went wrong with Venus can help planetary scientists compare Venus to Earth and to potential Earth-like exoplanets, which for the latter seems like an alluring opportunity as the search for alien life solidifies its place in the mainstream. But one space mission can't answer every scientific question, and they're really not meant to. That's why NASA chose a second mission to visit Venus called Veritas, which in a nutshell could be called Venus's personal cartographer. This spacecraft will orbit the planet, mapping it in greater detail than ever before. It'll plot the planet's surface elevation down to 30 meters a pixel and reveal exactly what the surface is made up of. Together, this data will give scientists the highest resolution global maps of Venus's surface to date. It's not an understatement to say that this map will shape our understanding of Venus for years, if not decades. Remember when I mentioned the phosphine study from 2020 that made a real splash in the scientific community? Well, Veritas could help clear the air on this one, so to speak. The spacecraft has an infrared spectrometer that can detect water vapor within erupted material. And if the instrument is finding plenty of water below the surface, as well as volcanism, it could point to phosphine coming from somewhere other than the planet's interior. Maybe even microbes in the clouds. Or maybe not, and it's coming from somewhere else. Until we get better data to either back up this theory about phosphine-producing microbes or to debunk it, the mystery will still stand. Regardless of what happens, this new treasure trove of data will be pretty impressive, and I, for one, can't wait to see some of these maps. Both NASA missions are expected to launch towards the end of the decade, but NASA isn't the only space agency gearing up for Venus. The Indian Space Research Organization is sending an orbiter called Shukrayan in 2024. The Russians are finally returning to Venus with a little bit of everything, an orbiter, a lander, and balloons that will launch in 2029, while the European Space Agency is sending an orbiter in the early 2030s. Altogether, that sounds like a party. There's gonna be balloons! So back to my original question. Why does it feel like Venus is suddenly everywhere in the news? Well, if you're thinking like I am, it seems like Venus mania isn't connected to one single cause. A controversial study that claimed they found signals of life in the thick clouds shows how preoccupied we all are with searching for life beyond Earth. Multiple space agencies are finally planning and developing missions to our forgotten neighbor after decades of neglect, and Venus represents an interesting version of Earth that's so similar to us but so radically different and inhospitable that it's worth studying. We get to witness what it's like if our own blue planet took a wrong turn billions of years ago. Venus is like an eerie, funhouse mirror that was covered up with a tarp for decades, but now the tarp has finally slipped off, and I just can't tear my eyes away from it. Maybe now you feel the same way. Hey, thanks for joining me on this Seeker Plus journey to Venus. I really enjoyed this one and learned a ton, and I hope you did too. If you like it, or if you have ideas for future series, be sure to let us know. You can find us on Twitter at Seeker, and I am on there too at Hug It Out. Thanks, and I'll see you for the next Seeker Plus.